Okay, hello everybody, and welcome to another video. I'm just going to assume that was a cut to the end of the video earlier, so if not, enjoy the awkwardness. Alright, so today we're going to be doing some pretty major stuff towards the end of the game, but I've done a little bit of grinding, not to make myself overpowered, and just give me a second to explain. I swear, the second I decide to record, people always start pissing about outside. Alright, so we have done stuff with the sphere grid. I want to keep you guys up to date. Basically, we are at what I would consider to be one of the main, like, ends of the game. We're not the end of the game, but we're about to face some very big stuff. So, let's have a look at the sphere grids. Now, with relative ease, you'll see Auron is 12 sphere levels above this. But with relative ease, you can get most of your characters now to the end of their sphere path. Each time someone hits the end of their path, they probably are going to learn a new ability. So here's Auron's path. We'll zoom all the way out. This was the route he took. He ends down here at this giant sphere here. And right at the bottom in the middle, he gets this ability here called Sentinel. He gets a ton of power in these last sections of his sphere grid. Look at that. That's 12 power right there. And a bunch more health too, okay? He's blocked by a level 3 block that eventually would lead him somewhere near the end of Whacker's path. Sentinel is the better version of Guard, which I'll show you guys in just a second. Basically, he just defends someone he likes, but he's defending actually as if he'd press triangle at the same time. So that's Auron. The next person is Titus. Titus is also now at the end of his path. When you last saw at the end of the last episode, he was like here or so. So all we did was a couple of levels just to get him into the middle. He's learned this ability here called Quick Hit. This is the last bit of time magic you will get in this game. It's a fantastic move that just lets you melee attack, physically attack, but with a less of a delay on it. So like it's faster than a normal hit. Animation wise, it doesn't look like you're hasted or anything, but if you combine this with say haste and then also delay attack and so forth, it's crazy. You get a bazillion turns in. In fact, it's so strong, I used a skill sphere on Auron so that once Titus unlocked it, I gave it to Auron straight away to make up for Auron's slowness, okay? Next we've got, where is he? Whacker. So Whacker is also at the end of his path. He takes the rightmost sphere. So as you can see here, basically all the guys, they're all like down here in the bottom left of the sphere grid with all their big damaging attacks. So Whacker's most recent ability was his final one called Triple Foul, which I've actually already talked to you about in the series. Ever since then, I've just stalled him here instead of going off with Lulu. What I'm actually going to do now is, because everyone's at the end, I'm going to use one of these friend spheres. We've only got one left, but I'm going to move him directly to the back of Auron's grid. You see? So now he's going to go reverse up Auron's grid. And all the power, the tankiness, and the... I guess, not really accuracy, because Whacker's already accurate enough. And the health, I guess, of Auron's path will now be open to Whacker too. So that's going to be pretty awesome, and we'll make some headway there. I'm not going to do that yet, though, because I don't want my character to be overpowered for the upcoming stuff. Kimari is, as ever, just slightly behind Lulu. Lulu learned this ability, Death, which I'll show you guys me casting in just a second. But up here, Lulu has come to a halt. So this is kind of what I consider to be the end of Lulu's path. Now, the women's paths tend to be a little bit more complicated than the others. Lulu's splits right at the end. You can either go to the left or you can go to the right. Should you choose to go to the left, you end with this big ability here in the middle called Double Cast. This was something Seymour was using on us a while ago that allows you to chain black magic together. One cast and then a second cast. Really, really fantastic ability. You can double cast anything Lulu has learned before. Double cast Bio, Demi, any of the elemental skills, whatever you like. Double cast Death and so on. If you go to the right, however, you'll find there's a really powerful ability blocked off by four level 4 key spheres. Now this is in the very top right of the grid on the expert grid, which is what I've been using, but this is the ability that appears in the very middle on the standard grid, I believe. That ability is Ultima. It is arguably one of the most powerful abilities in the entire game, certainly the strongest black magic. But it's also very difficult to get in Final Fantasy X and very unnecessary when you can be double casting other stuff. But imagine a double casted Ultima. So very strong, better in the sequel, I must say. But what we're going to do is we're going to have Lulu go off to the right, while Kimari, when he gets up here, he's going to go to the left. And together they're both going to unlock the stuff. And then Kimari will use a black magic sphere to instantly get Ultima. And Lulu will use a special sphere to instantly get double cast. And so they will work with one another like that. We'll talk about Riku last. And finally, we've got Yuna here. Yuna's come some distance since our last little episode. It's only maybe 40 minutes of grinding on Yuna. Mainly this is what it did. She was around here when we last spoke. She's gone. Oh, no. She was above there because she had Kyuraga. She was maybe about here then, I would guess, around this HP sphere. So we just moved her into here. In the very center of this grid, right near the end of her path, she gets this ability here called Full Life. This is life, but it raises someone fully up. And right around the back here was a level 4 lock, the first one I've unlocked, moving her over to this very powerful magic here called Holy. Now, the reason I did this was specifically to get Holy. Holy, I'll show you how it works in a battle soon enough, and we'll talk about it then. Lastly, we've got Riku. Riku's path is rather linear for quite a while. There's this little section here with a level 3 lock, but you don't. This is way before you get any level 3 key spheres. With the ability Pill for Gil, where you can steal Gil from people, which I just skipped past. Here was Mug, which we got a long while ago, as you know. But when you get here on Riku, her path is just terrible. I really don't like her path. She gets tons of empty nodes. Look at all these empty nodes all the way around here. Empty, 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 empty. Loads of agility. 4 agility here, 4 agility here, 4 agility here. 3 agility. So she gets very, very quick, right? But most of her path is just empty. And now you get a choice, though. The thing with Riku's path is it stops being linear very quickly. This entire top left section of the grid is all hers to explore however she likes. And it's messy, okay? So where do we want to go? You could go to the top. And if you go high, then you get this ability Auto Life that allows Riku to cast that thing we got from Hyper Mighty G the other day. We could go up here and get Quick Pockets. This is like Quick Hit, but for throwing items, so it's a really quick way to throw items. Really not that amazing in my opinion, but necessary for the hardest super bosses. Again, locked away by loads of level 4 locks. We could go ahead here, and there's some stats here, but a lot of empty nodes again. Once we get here, there's another split. We want to go up here and get this ability called Nab Gil. This is the Mug version of Pilfer Gil, which you probably won't see me using that much, if ever. Up at the very top here, again, a bunch more locks, more messy stuff. These locks just turn into empty nodes. So this entire thing here is just crap. There's no stats here at all. But if she gets through here, she'll learn some black magic, Flare. So you'd think Flare might be on Lu's path or something, but it's not. You see how Riku gets these weird abilities. Flare, one of the most powerful black magics. Auto Life, one of the most powerful white magics. It's odd, but that's the way they do it. Or you could even come over here and go down. And this is Bribe here, and this is that bit of Tidus's path I talked to you guys about a long time ago in the LP where you would break through with the level 3 lock. Well, after Bribe, you can even go down here, over here as well, to this thing called Copycat, which is a crazy ability. When you use Copycat, Riku will do whatever someone else just did, even if she knows the ability or not. So if you just had Lulu double cast Ultima, then you can have Riku Copycat Lulu, and Riku will double cast Ultima. It's pretty crazy, right? But that's a long way away, as you can see, and I just wanted to demo what her path was like. Anyway, so I didn't mean to spend too long on the sphere grid there. Let's actually get an encounter. I just want to show off some of these new abilities we've learned in action before we go ahead and complete the Zanuck and Cloister of Trials. I'm running around wondering why I'm not getting encounters because I put the Peaceful Bangle on. So we'll do that. We got some gear we've got to equip in a second as well to protect ourselves against various things. But all in due time. So here we go. Let's hope that this is actually a fight where we get some interesting stuff. All right, one of these guys. That's plenty of time. Okay, so Auron just got attacked with the ambush and instantly attacked back with a counter. What have I been doing wrong these previous episodes? I didn't have the Koetsu equipped on Auron. What is wrong with me? The thing with Auron here as well is because it's fire strike damage, and I missed out on all of this, because it's fire strike damage, he does tons of damage. He's hitting 9,999 suddenly, just randomly started doing it right at the end of his path because he's got their elemental weakness available to him right now. This enemy tends to be very tanky, though, so we don't have to worry about that. Let's bring in Wacker. I'll show you guys a triple foul. This is what was at the end of his path. And I think when I first used that, he said, this is going to hurt. Auron learns Sentinel, so we will show that off. Sentinel is a special move over here. Guard allies while in a defensive stance, you see, so it's just more powerful guard. So we'll do this. There's Sentinel. That's a haymaker, which it was aimed at Auron anyway, but he's going to counter. So Sentinel plus counter is like crazy strong, just like Provoke plus counter is crazy strong. Tidus learned quick hits. Look at the ATB bar with a regular, with like a delay attack or whatever. It would, I'd be delayed for ages. I wouldn't get another go, but with a quick hit, I get a go and then another go instantly. You see this? And I have an armor broken and then I get another go after that. So one of the main things you've got to do to keep up with the super bosses in this game, like late game, that you have to basically have everyone spamming quick hit all the time. And it becomes more a battle of MP rather than anything else. Yuna can use Kuraga here. I mentioned to you guys that Yuna was would get more offensive in these later stages of the game. And then I failed to demonstrate to you guys how that's true. Well, that's true because we've been fighting loads of zombified enemies around here. And Yuna can Kuraga them for about 6,000 damage. So she's hitting about as hard as Auron as long as it's against a zombified enemy. And that's something really powerful. You'll notice here we counter even when we evade, which is how I realised I'd done stupidly with my weapon. What else has changed? We've shown off all the stuff, really, haven't we? Oh, there is death. Now, because this is a machine, it's going to be immune to death, but there's only machines and zombied people here anyway. Now, death will instantly KO an enemy unless A, it's immune, or B, it's been zombified. So, really, it doesn't hit anything here. Death is best against those big fiends in the Gagazette Caves. Like, you could instantly death, say, a flan or whatever. But there you go, that's what death looks like. And, yeah, now we can just start quick hitting away. Even Auron can be quick hitting too. I think that's all of the abilities. The last one to show off is Holy, which is the main one. Let's use our overdrive here. Why? Because I feel like I must be really close to his third one by now. I used it a lot while I was playing, getting these spin levels. Lulu will be dead and won't get any experience here, but whatever, it doesn't matter too much. Nope, didn't unlock anything, that's fine. But yeah, look, check it out, Auron can quick hit, so now he's getting the extra speed. Anyway, the thing died. Those enemies actually aren't any good for grinding experience on at all.
That's how it's done.
But, you know, whatever. I made some weird little observations as well. I realized that zombied enemies, when they die, they don't explode into pyreflies, which sort of suggests that zombie is with this weird state where they're not even made of pyreflies anymore. That's the difference between, like, zombie as a status in this game and zombie as, like, a thing. You know, because all unsent seem like they're maybe zombies on some level, all fiends, but I guess the zombie status means it's just like a husk, it's walking around, there's no pyreflies powering it necessarily, it's just like this raw dark magic that's compelling them to. Anyway, that's all the mechanic stuff. Thanks for bearing with me for it. Let's go on into the Cloister Trials and we'll show off some awesome things. As I say, I quite like this cloister, but it's a bit of a weird one. And this is somewhere that my guide is going to come really in handy. So first we step on this platform here. And I'll turn on this TV. So this is another Cloister of Trials with Machina in it. And the TV shows us like these weird symbols. Now on the floor in this room are lots of little lights. Now each time we step on a light, it's going to reveal a symbol to us. So if we step on this one in front of us, you see it's like this Tetris piece. And that matches the Tetris piece on the screen at the bottom, like in a rough way. But there are also objects on the floor in here that aren't reflected on the screen, such as this one here is a white square. Well, that's not on the terminal, right, in front of us. That means we messed up. So all the lights go out. Well, now we have to try again. So there we go. We've got that Tetris piece. And you can sort of roughly guess where things are. That seems like that's where the yellow one would be. Yeah, this seems like it's got to be where the blue one would be. Yeah, we got that one right as well. Down here, this. So what do we want to do? Do we want to pick this one here on the right or the one just above it? Well, actually, this one just above it is the one we want, which gives you that. And then this would be a mistake to go on that one on the bottom right. It's actually this one up here to get the green thing, which is completely out of position. But by doing that and figuring that out, you get to open up the room to the next chamber. Everything starts glowing. And all these walls open up. Now, notice there are six pedestals that come out here. I feel like there's something about this Cloister of Trials that's unfinished or was in development or something. Because there are, you know how every time you get a new Cloister of Trials, you get like a sphere for that place? So you would get a Kilika sphere in Kilika, and you'd get a Bavel sphere in Bavel. There are no Zanakin spheres, but there is a Kilika sphere here, and there is a Besaid sphere here. And I feel like there was meant to be a sphere for each of these old pedestals. Instead you can just push some of them in, like so, straight away, and it doesn't, like, I don't know, it's just weird. I don't know how to explain it. I feel like there's something missing. I did do research, but even with my old notepad file, I wouldn't have been able to have elaborated more, just mused at the weirdness of it. So now we come in this next chamber, and there's seems to be a hole in the floor. That's our ultimate goal, but you can see on the screen in the background, we're basically just in a much bigger version of what we were in earlier. This can be very frustrating, however, my guide is pretty fantastic for this. There's a spider on my guide as well right now, a very, very itty-bitty spider. So my guide is pretty fantastic for this because it just shows you where all of the stuff is. Like, it just gives you a picture of this room as if everything was permanently lit up. It's literally just a memory game. So we want two of those, and hopefully you guys are keeping up with what I'm talking about here. You want two of those, and my guide is telling me the one in, just above me is actually a white square, so I want to be careful. I want to come down here and get another one of those, which should be here. There you go, so that's the two top things. Now I'm looking for two blue things. Now this one up in the top right should be one of those. There we go, with that orientation. And you know, the first time you do this, it's just going to be trial and error. Now we're looking for one that goes down somewhat, which should be this one over here. And lastly, we're looking for like a green Tetris piece. I mean, they're all Tetris pieces, really. Oh, I did not mean to walk on that. That would have been very bad. And then I believe this should be the green one here. Colors seem a bit weird. They don't quite match up. But there you go. So now we've done that. It flashes. We light up one of the pedestals here. Now that is actually the symbol of one of our aeons, whichever one we've just pushed in the previous room. You know, so this is the idea behind it. And maybe it's got some hints for temples that we never visited. Who knows? But that's one. Let's push in the next one. Oh, but this has a sphere-shaped recess and we can't do anything. Interesting. So I'll push in this one instead. So we need to repeat this process four times. Now we get this symbol here. I don't remember which aeon that was, but this one looks pretty simple. So we got to do two of the same things we did. Mostly this is the same as what it was before. So if you remember, we came up here and we hit, what was it? It was this one here, plus this one down here, which created the first box. Then we wanted to come to this one and the second one down here, which creates the second box, where it looks like this even more. So if we have a look at this one, you'll see, okay, that's another orange one. And up here, there we go. So that's the three boxes complete. Now we're just looking for the blue things. That'll be one of them. The other blue thing of that orientation is the one all the way over in the top right, which we got on the previous puzzle. And then the green Tetris piece thing, which can be found there. So there you go. That should be it. Yes, it is. Ah, and you might notice as it zooms in on the TV, you can actually see two spheres next to the TV. Alright, but if you come over here, it says a Kilika sphere is inserted here. Say do nothing. There is no point in taking those out. It will just turn off power to the TV at this point. So don't worry. Well, that's two symbols lit up. Let's go over here. Let's push this one in. So I guess the whole point of this is it's meant to be... I think that might be Bahamut, maybe. Or maybe I'm just saying that because it looks a bit like a bee. I think this is supposed to be, you know, us looking back at the whole pilgrimage. Or it's supposed to be some kind of Cloister of Trials where the design is such that any summoner trying to do it who hasn't, you know, been on a fulfilling pilgrimage, like you can't just walk to Zanarkand. Even if you had guardians powerful enough to get you there, you shouldn't just walk to Zanarkand because you wouldn't be able to complete this cloister. That's like the underlying tone of it that I feel it's trying to tell us. But I don't know for sure. Because obviously there are many temples and some temples fell apart and, you know, just whatever. So this one in the very bottom left corner is one of those, which we haven't seen yet. We do need a second one of the orange things, it looks like. I always mess up at some point on this, by the way. Is that me messing up there? Apparently it is. Did I already get that? That sucks. So there's one. And there's two. That's weird that I mentioned that just exactly as it happened. Over here should be this one and this one. Alright, so we're done, right? Okay, maybe I'd accidentally got one that I forgot I got. Okay, so now we need this blue one again. And then the L shape laying down, which is kind of a tricky one. Because the one just near this, you have to hit that. The other one next to it is a white box. Whenever you hit a white thing, basically, it's failure. This Cloister of Trials does have a secret in it, which I'm sure you've been thinking of. But it's weirdly designed in that you cannot acquire the secret for this Cloister of Trials the first time you come here. You can't get it. You have to come back later. Very, very weird. Anyway, that's another symbol lit. So one for each pedestal. So there's only one more we need to do now of this, you know, variety, and then we'll be fine. So we'll come back through, and it's this one up here on the top left. And hopefully this one isn't a huge issue. There are like multiple symbols and things for each aeon. There's like the symbols that appear on the door to Remium Temple for each one. Can't remember the specific term for what they're supposed to be. So another box. Box was here and down there. And then there's like a symbol for them as a part of the alphabet. And then there's like, you know how I was talking about Valor 4 has one that means nothingness in Buddhism or whatever. Where was that? This one here. And then I think there's like a third symbol as well. I can't remember what I was talking about. Okay, so wait, we're going to come down over to this one. I always knew, I remember doing my test file, and I remember thinking I was going to struggle with commentary here. Because, like, what are you supposed to say? All right, up here. Now, it's one of these three in front of me. It's the one at the very top, this one here. Is that it? Oh, no, what are we missing? What are we missing? Oh, another blue thing. Ah. So that one there? Yes, there we go. So now there's just two platforms left. And what we do for these two platforms is you come up and you take these spheres out of the TV. So a Kilika sphere. Why is a Kilika sphere here? Well, it has to be in reference to previous things from, like, other temples, right? Gonna take this Killica sphere and we're gonna insert it into this sphere-shaped recess over here. And that will automatically slide it in, and that activates that one straight away for us. Without having to do the puzzle. Also sets out the lights. I really like that. It's weird, isn't it? Kind of setting out the lights like that. And then lastly, there's a Besaid sphere here. And by placing this one in on the right-hand wall, I don't know whether you can mix those walls up or what. That's the Cloister of Trials complete. Bit of a weird one. Do you guys think it's a bit forced in? I don't know. I feel like the pilgrimage wouldn't be complete without something like this. And the fact that it does seem to be reflecting on previous temples, I don't know. And besides, I like that puzzles are a part of what it is to play Final Fantasy. You'll see, now the whole floor's lighting up and a save sphere's appeared in here. Make sure you use that save sphere. Absolutely make sure you use it. And I'm going to do something for us here as well. We're going to have a quick look at our gear, okay? Now, the enemy we're about to fight counterattacks constantly. So, one of your best ways of doing damage to him is through your counters, okay? So, keep the Kotetsu on Auron if I were you. I'm going to keep the Avenger on. But he also does a stat we haven't really seen yet. So I was lying when I said Curse was the last stat. We have seen Berserk. We saw the Wendigo with Berserk. This guy will Berserk us. I think he's like one of the only people in the entire game that inflicts Berserk on us. And think about how early in the game we were getting Berserk Ward gear. We got Berserk Ward gear back at friggin' Operation Meehan. It's crazy. So equip your Berserk Ward stuff. The whole way through this LP, I've just been holding on to the odd bit of Berserk Ward gear if I found it on any of my characters. So this one has it here on this bangle. Just so that I knew at this point in the game I could use it. Now, that's actually kind of important. The only time I got a game over, or my first, like, my real only game over on my test file recently, was against this boss we are about to fight. So I actually only have it on two people, funnily enough. So that's a bit frustrating. But, you know, I don't feel over-leveled, but we are at least appropriately leveled. So let's move in. And remember how I told you guys that there was more than one keeper? Yeah, well, we're about to meet the second keeper. Previous one wasn't so bad, was it, really? Sanctuary Keeper? I think that's why I got a bit big-headed as well. I was like, yeah, Sanctuary Keeper, he's not so bad on my test file. I'm sure Spectral's fine as well. So, stealing from this guy, you get either an Aether or a Turbo Aether. He's the final challenge from Lady Unalesca. Titus doesn't have an overdrive up because I literally just used it. And here we will have trigger commands. These are to move. So there is an element of positioning in this battle, which I'll demonstrate soon when it becomes important. First of all, we're going to haste Aether. I don't really want Lulu on my front line here at all, but everyone deserves at least one go. Auron here is going to, I guess, just quick hit. And you should see his counter straight away. So whenever he gets attacked, he counters by attacking everyone in front of him. So this is why you may like to move. First for Lulu here. So here's something cool as well, right? You should always swap in Riku if you want to use items after a while because she's so fast. So by using Riku here, I can Mega Potion. And look, Riku gets an extra turn instantly. So it's almost like that turn never existed. So now I can bring Lulu back. And it's, you know, there's very little difference at all. Here for Lulu, I want to show you guys what it's like when you get to the end of the game and use an early level black magic when Lulu's got very high magic power. So we're going to use Fire Fury and spin. Ah, I messed up there. Jesus. It does go much quicker, as you can see. I started messing up because it's weird spinning that thing so fast. But yeah, you can get very high. You can get like 14, 15 or whatever. But obviously that was dangerous because he just countered the crap out of us. Again, so it's like, would you want to use an item or something? So bring Riku in. Throw your Phoenix down or whatever it is you have to do. And she should have got another go there. Okay, she didn't. That's fine though. All right, so it's about to be the Spectral Keeper's turn. What do we want to do here? I guess what we want to do is heal Titus back up. So let's get him nice and high so he doesn't lose his haste soon. And here you can see he's using this ability called Berserk Tail. So I have now lost control of Riku. She will only ever attack. She'll do a little bit more damage, but she will only ever attack. And that's going to keep causing this guy to counter. Now he's also changed the position he's facing, So now he's going to be countering again and hitting those three glyphs that Riku and Tidus are on, but Lulu is safe. So we got to figure out how we're going to deal with this. Now I need Lulu off the board, so I'm going to have to haste her with Tidus there. She's had her go. It's such a chore to give her a go and make her leave. Also, look at how much Overdrive Gorge has charged. That's just because of Comrade, that is. Alright, so now that we've done that, we can move someone in. Now, this is basically a free spot. So we'll move Yuna in, demonstrate some of our new magic. Life was the old one, which would revive someone. Full life will revive them with 100% health. It's like an alchemy player throwing a phoenix down. So there you go. Riku's back up. I could try and haste her. She's pretty quick. It might give her a go. It doesn't before he gets another one. So we've got to be cautious here. I'm going to throw another X potion on Tidus. Probably going to berserk again. Really, you want him to berserk slow characters. I love having Auron out here. So again, Riku's going to do the same. She's going to cause him to attack straight away because it's her go next. Oh no, okay, sweet. So now we get one turn, basically, to get that berserk off of Riku. So we are going to throw a remedy on her. Unlike Curse and Zombie, this can be cured with Azuna. I really think at some point in this game's development, it was going to have a lot more... use. There was going to be a lot more Berserk in the game, but maybe they just thought it was OP or annoying or something. Alright, so, and also what we're going to do is we're going to move Tidus to a glyph where he won't get hit if the boss ever counters. Like that. So now both Yuna and Tidus are behind the Spectral Keeper. Now, I could mix with Riku right now. Maybe we'll do that. Maybe we'll save it for later. But for now, what I want to do is bring Auron in, and I want to use... Oh, no. Ah, damn it. Tidus is the only one that can provoke right now. So, provoke is a thing with this boss. You can cause him to only attack the same person. But I did not on this playthrough teach Auron provoke. That's fine, though. So, we'll just have him use his... really, he needs to heal, doesn't he? Or we could have him overdrive. No, let's heal him. Let's play it cautiously. I get very nervy around this fight now that I know I lost. I just got in a situation where everyone was berserked and we just got wrecked instantly. So Yuna's got her overdrive up. I'm not going to worry too much about that. I will, however, cast Protect on Auron. Protect is incredibly powerful here. Actually, instead of that, let's bring in Riku and cast Hyper Mighty G. So we'll go down to Wings of Discovery. I don't really want to rely on this, but, you know, it's going to be useful. Where are the Wings of Discovery? Are they down here? Oh, here we go, even further down. Wings of Discovery, not two of them for the really cheaty one. We'll just go for this. Lunar Curtain, I've got a bunch of these. Hyper Mighty G, it's a staple, it's really, really solid. Protect, Shell, Regen, Auto Life, all that stuff. So he's turned again, now he's hitting Tidus. Tidus counters, that's good. And also he didn't get Berserked because he has Berserk Ward Armor on him, and that helps you out massively in this fight. So we will commence with the quick hits, I think. I mean, Riku's going to get hit a little bit here, but she should be okay, especially considering she's got Auto Life on her and Protect. See, everyone's taking a bit less damage and their health's going up significantly. We could throw a Mega Potion with Auron here. We could also bring Kamari in, which is what I'd rather do. And instead of using a Mega Potion, how about we use White Wind? Now, as an overdrive, this shouldn't be reduced by Shell. There you go. That brings everyone back up. That's good, man. You don't often get an excuse to use White Wind, but there it is. All right, so we will go another quick hit. For as long as it's you having turns and not the enemy, you're in control. Now we can get Riku off the board. Wacker hasn't had a go yet. And I suppose what you can do as well is just move Wacker over there. And now if we provoke the boss with Tidus, he's going to stay facing these three glyphs and the other two are going to be safe behind him. Well, that's the plan anyway. Ah, so now he's cast one of his new abilities. This is called Glyph Mine. You see, under Tidus... there is a glyph, and under Kamari, there is a glyph. Well, when these get a turn, they'll explode and instantly kill anyone who stood on them. So we're going to have to move Tidus here somewhere else. Now, you'll notice there's a glyph under Kamari, and Kamari doesn't get a go before that thing blows up. This is because he's so slow, and it's really kind of annoying me, actually. So Kamari might be about to die, and it's going to be really hard to get him off the board again. There you go. So Kamari's down and out. That's what it looks like to die to a glyph. Usually, you get a lot more leeway. Before that something like that happens. So we will Phoenix down. See, the other thing we could do is swap our weapon, which would give us another go, to the Lifesaver. Then we can Phoenix down. And yeah, we're not countering right now, but we just doubled Kamari's health for free, so why not? Whack is still on the board now. Is there anything else that he's weak to? I don't think he's weak to really anything. We could try triple fouling him. But all this is going to do is cause him to counter and hit Titus, who's currently in front of him. Now, the reason I didn't move Titus completely out of range is because I don't see the point in it. There's a Berserk Tail. And because Titus is so quick, right? Because of the resistance, man. That's so good having that gear. That's so good. All right, let's try and haste Kamari. Man, look at this crap. That's the one thing I don't like about putting Kamari down Lulu's path that I've learned on this playthrough. It's such a pain, man. I guess you can silence this enemy as well. It's such a pain to have him be so slow. Anyway, we'll X Potion there. He might finally get the Berserk in a moment. We should... and that's two counters that we missed out on, by the way. All right, I think everyone's had a go now. Auron can come back out. Let's make with the Banishing Blade, the Breaking Blade. Drink your nog. All right, up L1, down L1, juggle. I quite like that. It's like entering old cheat codes. Any breaks that we can put on him, this will put on, undoubtedly. About 6k damage. It's not bad either. Here's another counter. All right, now swap back to the friggin'... Oh yeah, I got this new weapon here, the Prism Steel as well, which has magic counter on it by default. It's pretty cool. Get a lot of awesome stuff, actually, if you hang around in the later areas of the game. Okay, so Titus is a little low right now, so I think I'll bring Yuna in and hit him with a Kuraga. He's already got all of his defensive magics on him, so that should be fine. There we go. God, I found it so hard to target him there. Now, Shell will reduce this, but because it's such strong magic, and as I'll demonstrate to you guys in a second, Yuna is such a strong spellcaster, we should be fine. So we'll go for a couple more quick hits here. He's got 33k of health left. Ideally, you want like a tanky guy in front of him. Titus is now almost out of MP, so that's pretty bad. He should survive this now. I'm going to defend here. There we go. Defend. So that's a Berserk Tail. Didn't do very much damage. There's a counter. That's fine. Auron should be able to attack very soon. So, what did we want to leave Yuna out, or do we want to go back to someone else? This is the thing. This is kind of a long fight. I don't know how much I enjoy this fight, because every time it's, oh, there's another counter. Here's another counter. We can stop him with another silence. This is really the entire thing. Move off of the glyphs. I think he can't really cast any mines at the moment, because we got him silenced. But, yeah. I could swap Titus out. No, I'll just have him heal himself. Use him through a lot of X potions, but I really don't mind. Because we're going to swap to a different save file later anyway, where I was more conservative, so who cares. Quick hit. Oh yeah, because we're out of mana. Now, of course, because Titus is so fast right now, one thing I could have just done is move him out of the way. We'll quick hit with Auron here, so he gets another go quicker. This could be Titus dead, but auto life will bring him back if it happens. There's some glyph mines, okay. Alright, so Waka's on one. That's going to mess us up a little bit. It means Waka's going to be in the line of fire. But I can move Titus over there. Oh, I don't... Yeah, and then I guess he's probably going to turn to Titus in a second. This gives us a free attack on him with Auron, because he's going to counter, but no one stood there, you see? So you probably can be a bit smarter with your positioning than I've been. Oh, what? See, Waka didn't get a go! This is annoying me, man. That's not meant to happen that way. Wasn't he there for Hyper Mighty G either? I guess he wasn't. Alright, so we will Phoenix down. I'm not going to get rid of my, this time, my weapon. I'll just leave Wacker like that. Wacker is very strong. He's just not really had much opportunity this time. The regen's very helpful here. I did actually skip over unlocking regen for Yuna, just so that she could get to Holy quicker on her path. And Holy's not something I want to demo in this fight, so... If you've been wondering why I haven't done it, it's on purpose. So yeah, right now, we're actually in a really good spot, so we'll just keep attacking until eventually he turns. Hopefully he wants to do another glyph mine, but something tells me he won't. So there's a Berserk Tail. Titus resists once again. All of his attacks are going to go on to Titus. We have enough mana just for a regular haste, so I'll give that to Wacker so he can actually move somewhere. Auron remains behind. Titus's health is a little low. I'm just going to heal him up with the high potion. I don't want to pop his halo too early. All right, that's fine. Now we can move Waka behind the Spectral Keeper. He's probably going to be on a glyph mine now, sadly. Auron hasn't had to move this entire fight. Okay, that's cool. So Auron can attack here. Now, Titus is still going to have to be in the line of fire here. My plan was to move him behind the boss as well to here, but a glyph mine just appeared there, so we can't. But what we do have to move is at least move out of the mine we're currently stood on. I don't think he does more damage if it's a slight side-on angle. I think it's just, hey, he takes a lot of damage. Ideally, I want to be defending with Titus. So I guess I'll just Silence Buster instead of triple fouling. Mana's running low on these three. There you go, 1.3. Heal up with an X Potion. Now, if I had quick pockets, I could probably X Potion and then defend very quickly. But same with Riki's grid, man. I don't know whether it's just on Expert. I don't know what it's like on Standard, but I really don't like her path. So now that those mines have blown up, I can move Titus over here. And we can get a couple more free hits without worrying about anything. I do want to quickly bring Yuna in as well. That's the ice cream van, by the way. Ages ago when I was doing, I think it was my LP of Bioshock. He's got 11,000 health. I think it was my Bioshock LP. That thing used to come around all the time. And it was like a bit of a thing in the series. I wonder how many of you guys watching this watched that. Jeez, that was a long time ago. That was like during the Guild Wars 1 LP. All right, so that guy's down. And we'll get one more here. All right, he's out of mana. That's fine. Another reason you want to give Auron a lot of mana. It's not just for Mug. So now he's going to turn and hit Titus again. Oh no, he's just casting Glyph Mines. So how long do I get before the mines blow up? Loads of time this time. All right, what I'm going to do here is I'm going to attack. He'll counter and miss, and I know Titus is still stood on a mine, and that could seem very deadly. But the plan here is to then attack with Wakatu. And then what I can do is move Auron in front, who's like the tankier guy, and then I could move Titus to where Auron is, and he'd be safe. However, all that said, I believe the boss is now under 10,000 health. We're going to go with the tried and tested Grand Summon. Oh, he's already got his overdrive up anyway. All right, fine. We'll keep the Grand Summon for later. So we'll summon Behemoth. If he's got less than 10k health, there's nothing a Mega Flare can't deal with. If you feel like I'm hogging Behemoth a bit much, don't worry. You'll see plenty of the other ones later. So Mega Flare. And it's weird actually summoning Aeon here. They appear on this random rock out in the middle of nowhere. I think the whole point of that rock is to make Ifrit's overdrive makes sense, where he like tears the ground out. Otherwise, why would they ever have to do it? Look, Behemoth's now hitting 23,000 damage. And that, guys, is the entrance to the final Chamber of the Faith, the final Aeon. Blade open.
Yuna, we're here.
The Hall of the Final Summoning.
Go.
Yes.
She goes down alone as well. I guess the summoner was always alone when they went down to those places.
What do you mean, no final Aeon?
Sir Auron! Everyone!